So the topic, the title of the topic is the aesthetics of grammar. And when I say aesthetics, I mean the principles which are involved in this grammar. They are not changeable. They are static and they remain as they are. We cannot alter them. And I would like to call it functions of symbols or symbolism in literature, because the work which you are producing as your thesis is a piece of literature. And then in the piece of that literature, you are applying certain symbols. Those symbols actually make difference to whatever you have written. If the symbol is not placed at a proper place, the meaning of the whole sentence changes. And that affects a lot to the reader or to the examiner, whosoever is studying your script. So one has to be very careful when we are applying these symbols to our text. Now the most important thing among the symbol is the punctuation marks. And again, once again, the punctuation marks are such a simple thing. Everybody knows what a punctuation mark is or what are the punctuation marks. But perhaps if I ask you how many punctuation marks are there, maybe you cannot count. Maybe you can say 3 or 4 and that's all. That will be end of your count. But as a whole, there's a group of these punctuation marks. But let me tell you about the etymology of punctuation from medieval Latin 1530. And these are this, if you look at that, go through this slide. Once again, as we know, most of the terminology which is inserted into English has come from the Latin language. So there are various names which are applied to the punctuation, like the punctuation M and the punctus and pungere, etc., etc. So this is the etymology which started as far back as 1530, but when by the year 1660, the punctuation had reached a stage of quite a maturation. And then it became a part of parcel of all literature. Then we have the second word, which is the grammar. The grammar, if I put it simply, grammar simply means a kind of magic. It is a kind of incantation or a spell or numbo jumbo. Jaise koi aap jadoo kar rahe hain, toh agar bhi ye jadoo, if you are this jadoo is not inserted into your text, toh phir ye jadoo kaam karta nahi hai. The basic meaning or the literal meaning of grammar is this, the jadoo. So jadoo aapka itna important cheez hai ki when you are writing your thesis, to aapne us thesis ke har line mein ye jadoo dalna hota hai. So agar aap jadoo theek tarah nahi dalenge, to the whole thing will appear distorted to your examiner or to your reader. Now here I have an example. The sentence is here. If you can read it, this is one sentence, one who can does, who cannot teaches. So isme kya, do you make any sense? Can you make any sense in this sentence? Matlab kya iska? Isko aap padhe ek dafa, do dafa padhe, teen dafa padhe, then tell me the meaning of this sentence.
Sir, without punctuation, it cannot be read.
So without punctuation, I think it makes no sense. So let's do some punctuation. This is the punctuation. So the punctuation says one who can, a person who can do something, he does it. So usse kaam karna aata hai. But who cannot, usko karna nahi aata, wo padhane lag jata hai. Just like me. So now with the help of these comma and the semicolon, the whole sentence makes it in some sense. Huh? And that is what I am trying to emphasize. Ki jo commas hain aur the other grammatical marks hain, yeah, the punctuation marks, they actually work a lot. They work like a magic. So just by adding a comma and semicolon and a full stop, we have made a sense out of this sentence, which otherwise was ununderstandable. Just look at it, this sentence makes no sense at all. But by virtue of these punctuation marks, the whole thing is in order. Then I have a quotation from Julius Caesar. He has said that acta sans verba. The translation is the action, not words. But action, not word, again, it makes no sense unless the punctuation marks are added to this. And if we add the punctuation mark, it is like this, acta, comma. That means Julius says action, we need action, not word, not the words. So the ecta, then comma, and sans verba will go outwards. But if the if we place the comma after sans, then the meaning become absolutely different, or the opposite meaning. Now ecta sans mean no action, was only takreer kar rahe, jaise hamare leader karte hain. Action koi nahi hai, sirf takreer hai. So in the first example, which is the top line, this is the example of what the Julius Caesar says. And in the second case, it is an example whatever leader says, ke baatein bahut kar rahe hain, action koi nahi hai. So once again, the comma is the something, or the comma is the magic thing in this sentence. But then it doesn't, the whole thing doesn't end here, since the ecta sans verba is the dialogue coming from Julius Caesar, so we have to put it in the inverted commas. But again, it doesn't end there, since it is a dialogue coming from the mouth of a person, then we have to italicize it and put inverted commas on both sides. So that is how we quote the dialogue in our thesis. Italicized if it is a dialogue, and then inverted commas on both sides. But remember, when I say dialogue, only dialogue you can italicize and put in inverted comma. If it is not a dialogue, then the method is different, which we'll see later on in today's lecture. Now, the another very interesting example of this punctuation mark is this, that a professor wrote this sentence on the board and asked his students to punctuate it. A woman without her man is nothing. So this is a dialogue. Now, where do we put the punctuation mark? That is the problem which the teacher gave to the students. So the class comprised girls as well as boys, and obviously the boys came out with their own suggestion and the girls came out with their own suggestion. And we look at the first suggestion given by the boys. The boys in the class punctuated the sentence like this: a woman, comma, without her man is nothing. So this is what the punctuation mark says in this sentence. That means a woman without her man, agar uska miyan kuch nahi hai, uska miyan koi nahi hai, so then woman is just nothing. So this is what the boys said. But on the other hand, the girls in the class punctuated it like this: a woman, colon, without her man is nothing. So ek aurat ke bagair jo man hai wo kuch nahi hai. So once again, just look at the magic which these punctuation marks have played in this single sentence. So that is what we have to, or I have to emphasize in today's lecture, and what the purpose of today's lecture is, that when you are inserting these punctuation marks in your script, they can change the whole thing. They can change the whole meaning. And you have to be very, very careful when you are applying these punctuation marks to your thesis or your script. Let's see then what are the 14 punctuation marks in English grammar. These 14 marks are, the following are the 14 marks. That is, number one is the period. Now, period is an American terminology. In English, we call it a full stop. Then there's a question mark, explanation point, comma, semicolon, colon, dash, hyphen, parenthesis, brackets, braces, apostrophe, quotation marks, and ellipsis. These are the only 14 magical marks which are used in English. Now, some of the words might be new to you. For example, bracket. We often use the word bracket, which is applied to many type of brackets. Like, actually, the bracket doesn't mean by itself nothing. Either we have to say parentheses, or we have to say brackets, or we have to say braces. What kind of brackets we are using? We have to be very clear on this. Then apostrophe, I hope you know what apostrophe is. Quotation mark is very simple. And maybe ellipses is something which is not clear to you at the moment. But I will certainly explain to you during the course of this lecture. Punctuation is also called letter pointing. And letter pointing is very important, because at places we add certain dots, at certain places we add certain dashes or certain oblique lines. All these elements in the script are known as the letter pointing. Now, letter pointing is the use of spacing, conventional signs, and certain typographical devices as aids to the understanding and correct reading of handwritten or unprinted text, whether read silently or loudly. So these punctuation marks become very important. Chahe aapko dil mein pad rahe ho, chahe uncha pad rahe ho, ya speech kar rahe ho, they make a lot of difference to the understanding of the text which is in front of you and which you are reading. Another description is the practice action or system of inserting points or other small marks into text in order to aid interpretation, division of text into sentences, clauses, etc. by means of such marks. So the once again, the purpose of these punctuation marks remain the same. We can break a sentence at certain place, and then we can break in many ways. Do we want to make a break? We want to give a longer break or a shorter break or a medium break. What kind of break we want to introduce in our sentence? And when I say small break or medium break or longer break, for each of these break there is a different kind of symbol or different kind of punctuation mark. The 3 of the 14 punctuation marks are appropriate for use as sentence ending. They are the period, that is full stop, question mark, and the exclamation point. When I say period, period is American and full stop is English, as I said. Now, these three signs or symbols, if the sentence ends at these points with a full stop or a question mark or the exclamation point, that would mean that the next sentence is starting with a capital letter. Next sentence will start with a capital letter after the space of one letter. So that is an important thing to remember. All other signs, which are 11 in number, unke baad jo aapka sentence shuru hoga, wo small letter se shuru hoga, big letter se ya capital letter se shuru nahi hoga. But in tino ke baad jo aapka letter aayega, jo sentence shuru hoga, that will be from with the capital letter. The period is placed at the end of declarative sentences and other statements thought to be complete and after many abbreviations. For example, there is an example: as a sentence ended, the period or full stop is placed at the end of a sentence. For example, the sentence is Javed and Jameel went to the market, and then there is the full stop. The sentence is complete. The full stop is also used at in some certain cases of the contractions and at certain conditions of abbreviations and so on. For example, we see at the bottom line, after abbreviation, professor came and went. So we can write prof, instead of full professor, we can simply say prof, P-R-O-F and full stop. If we don't put the full stop, then it is wrong. Since it is a contracted form of professor, then after P-R-O-F, we have to put a full stop or a period. Similarly, if we want to say doctor was absent, then after D-R, we will put a full stop or a period. Now the question might come to your mind, why for professor we have a P-R-O-F, why there is no R at the end, like R at the end in the doctor. But these are the contractions which have been formalized by the English language, and there is no proper answer to this kind of contractions. But nevertheless, just say, if I ask you one small question, जब हम नंबर लिखते हैं नंबर तो उसको लिखते हैं एन ओ एंड फुल स्टॉप तो नंबर का तो एन आर होना चाहिए व्हाई इट इज एन ओ व्हाट इज द रीजन डू यू हैव एनी आइडिया कभी आपने सोचा कि नंबर के लिए एन ओ क्यों लिखते हैं नो उसका तो एन आर होना चाहिए ये सिर्फ एन ओ व्हाई सो
सर इट्स न्यूमेरो से है आई थिंक द वर्ड नंबर
एग्जैक्टली वेरी राइट
फ्रॉम लैटिन
The Latin number is numero, N-U-M-E-R-O. That's why it is N-O in abbreviation or the contracted form. Bilkul sahi aapne kaha, very good. Use a question mark to indicate direct question when placed at the end of a sentence. For example, when did Abdul leave for the market? So when there is a question involved in your sentence, then you can put a question mark at the end of that sentence. The exclamation point is a kind of surprise or is a kind of a question or implied question, not a question, direct question, but an implied question. जैसे आप कभी जब हैरान हो जाते हैं तो उसके लिए क्या करना है? So that is the kind of exclamation point which we use. So we want to express sudden outcry or some kind of emphasis on our sentence, then we use the exclamation point. विदिन ए डायलॉग वी कैन से एग्जाम्पल आप बैठे हुए अपने कमरे में अचानक कोई थीफ आ जाए तो आप जनरली से वो थीफ एंड देन यू कैन पुट दिस मार्क देयर आफ्टर द थीफ It shows your surprise and sudden question. Then we can also use it to emphasize a point. For example, we can say, my mother-in-law rants make me furious. So mother-in-law to bichari badi badnaam se cheez hai. Pata nahi badnaam. Bichari kehna chahiye, nahi kehna chahiye, I don't know. So when we say my mother-in-law rants, but what are the rants? Ji, rants kya cheez hai?
To complain about something.
Bas tans karna aur kaise kya karna chahiye? तंज ही करते रहना चाहिए हर वक्त कुछ ना कुछ नक्स ही निकालना हर चीज में से रेंट्स आर दैट थिंग इरिटेटिंग पॉइंट्स जो होते हैं सो रेंट्स मेक मी फ्यूरियस सो दिस लेडी इज सेइंग द मदर इन लॉ रेंट्स मेक मी फ्यूरियस तो इसमें देयर इज अ क्वेश्चन आल्सो देयर इज अ हिडन क्वेश्चन इन इट क्या क्या किया जाए और उसका आंसर ही कोई नहीं है सो देयर इज अ हिडन क्वेश्चन इन इट एंड दैट्स व्हाई वी पुट द एक्सप्लेनेशन हियर